Hi, this is Professor Pope, and this is a narrated PowerPoint presentation on medical aid in dying for the Albany Medical Center bioethics course. So I'm going to proceed in five stages here in about 100 slides. And first, I'm going to just talk about terminology. Second, legal history. Third, moving from history to what's happening right now or what's about to happen. And then finally, to turn to a relatively brief summary of arguments made by proponents to legalize medical aid in dying, and then opponent arguments. So let's start with terminology. So if you go back to some of the older sources from the 1990s, for example, and into the 2000s, the dominant term in the medical literature, the bioethics literature, the legal literature, in formal proceedings, is always it's assisted suicide or physician assisted suicide, because well, for one reason, that's what the statutes say. And so here I'll just give you an example of the statute in my state, Minnesota. So in Minnesota, there's a criminal statute, and it says whoever intentionally assists another in taking the other's life may be sentenced to imprisonment. So this is, a criminal statute. Obviously, you can be imprisoned and or fined. And this sort of criminal statute is not unique to Minnesota. In fact, this is a crime everywhere. Every state criminalizes assisting a suicide. It's just part of the regular criminal code. We criminalize homicide and all sorts of crimes, and this is one of those crimes. Now, when those laws were enacted, nobody was thinking of physician-assisted suicide specifically, although a small handful of states have a separate and additional criminal statute that specifically prohibits that conduct. But the question for a long time has been whether or not the conduct that we're going to talk about, which is a physician giving a lethal dose of barbiturates to a patient, constitutes assisted suicide and therefore falls within the scope of the criminal prohibition that is in every state. And so person to person, so putting aside physician aid in dying, right, there are lots and lots of cases where you have one person helping another person hasten their death. There are movies about this. There are organizations that will provide various levels of advice or counsel, or even helping you get drugs from veterinary drugs from Mexico and so forth. All right, so all of that is still going to be criminally prohibited as assisted suicide in many instances. So that's generally not changing, right? There's no move to decriminalize assisted suicide. And in one important level, that's not really our focus at all. Instead, what we're going to focus on is aid in dying is a very specific type of conduct. And what is intended by this is the following. Aid in dying is when you have a physician prescribing medication to a patient with capacity who is terminally ill, which the patient may ingest herself to bring about death. So just to flag this, there are three big key elements here in the definition of physician aid in dying. One is it's a physician-patient relationship, right? And it's a prescription written within the scope of that relationship. Second, the patient has capacity to consent to that. Third, the patient is terminally ill. And fourth, the patient self-ingests. The physician is not doing something to the patient. The patient is ingesting it herself. So that those are the basic key elements of the definition. Now, of course, conceptually, aid in dying is a subset of assisted suicide because you have one person, the physician, who is helping another person cause their own death, right? So the, arguably, at a conceptual level, the patient is committing suicide because they're ingesting a lethal substance that will cause their death relatively quickly, and the physician is helping, assisting the patient to do that by providing the medication. So conceptually, aid in dying is assisted suicide. It's one particular type of assisted suicide. But a lot of scholars, as well as in the court system, as well as in the legislative moves to legalize aid in dying, people think that it's so distinct, meaning this is not somebody who is relatively healthy and wants to avoid a financial situation or a romantic problem and things like that, which might be causes of suicide. These are people who are already dying, like they're already terminally ill, so they already have, and normally it's cancer, they already have less than a 6-month prognosis. So it's not the same. It looks different from what people normally think of as suicide. So therefore, since it has such a distinct nature, it should have a distinct name. And that's why generally, at least people who are supporters of aid in dying don't refer to it as physician-assisted suicide. The word suicide has a negative connotation that they don't think is appropriate to latch onto the concept of aid in dying, which is sort of somebody taking control of their end of life pathway. And so this terminology supported by a number of medical associations like the American Public Health Association, the American Medical Women's Association, and a few others. So that's the terminology point. So let's turn from terminology to legal history. And we could go back really, really far, but at least as far as the U.S. legal history, let's just go back to 1997. And this is a good place to start because in 1997 is the year that the U.S. Supreme Court, the U.S. Supreme Court in 1997 heard two cases that were about aid in dying. And the two cases, one came from New York and one came from Washington. And basically, in both cases, those patients wanted the court to declare that there was a constitutional, under the U.S. Constitution, a constitutional right to aid in dying. But the Supreme Court declined to declare that there was any such right. So the patients... petitions, the patient's requests were denied, even though they had won, actually, in the lower courts. When they got to the U.S. Supreme Court, the Supreme Court said there is no constitutional right. So if the state of New York or the state of Washington wants to criminalize this conduct, they may. It's a state level issue, and the U.S. Constitution doesn't impose any limits on whether or not the state can or may criminalize it or not. It doesn't impinge the patient's fundamental rights to criminalize the conduct and to deny them access to aid in dying. Now, notably, when this decision was made, Justice O'Connor, who was still on the court at the time, noted that the following. He says, well, look, the states are undertaking an extensive and serious evaluation here. And I think what she's referring to here is Oregon at the time, which is unlike New York at the time, and New York now, moving to legalize aid, medical aid in dying. And so she's recognizing that some states are going to criminalize it, some states are going to decriminalize it. And she thinks, look, this is good. This is good. The challenging task of crafting appropriate procedures for safeguarding liberty interests is entrusted to what she calls the laboratory of the states. Let's let the states try this out, see how it works, let them develop the appropriate procedures and safeguards. And so, as I said, this what was already happening is in 1994, this is before the U.S. Supreme Court ruled, Oregon had a ballot initiative. And the popular ballot vote was to legalize aid in dying. And so now it was caught up in court challenges, which we won't get into because it's kind of a long and rocky, windy road. But it was first the ballot initiative in 1994. And finally, after getting past all those hurdles in the court system, it really got into operation. The Oregon Death with Dignity Act got into operation in 1997 and has been going ever since. And talking about Oregon for not just because it's first, because it's the pioneer here, but also because Oregon is the model, the template, the mold on which every other state has patterned its plan to legalize medical aid in dying. So let's looking at Oregon, right, in terms of eligibility, right? Who gets to use this? Who gets to ask a physician for a prescription for a lethal dose of barbiturates? Well, you have to have a terminal illness. So it's a patient with a terminal illness, which means a six-month prognosis or less. You have to be an adult, and you have to have decision-making capacity. How is the request made? Again, the statute, and again, the Oregon statute is the same pretty much as Washington, pretty much the same as Vermont, pretty much the same as California. The doc has to educate the patient about all the other options, right? The patient may have asked about aid in dying, but perhaps palliative care, pain management, hospice are sufficient alternatives to address the patient's concern, such that aid in dying might not be the best, most appropriate choice for them. The patient has to make an oral request, have a waiting day of 15 days, and make a second oral request and a written request, and then wait 48 hours. And the idea of this is to make sure that this is settled and deliberated and reflected upon by the patient. Both the treating physician and the consulting physician must approve, meaning they have to approve, you know, that the patient is terminally ill, that the patient has capacity, and so there's a double safeguard. every request is even accepted. Only one in six requests are accepted. So either the doctor doesn't agree that the patient is eligible, or because of the relatively rigorous informed consent procedures, the patient finds another treatment plan other than aid in dying. Now, if the patient is eligible and the doctor follows the safeguards, agrees to write the prescription, the doctor writes the prescription, the patient normally would get that at the pharmacy, and the patient must self-ingest, right? So this is not administered by the physician. It's administered by the patient herself. So this is a safeguard that's been built in. The patient takes the final overt act. This is why it's called, or it used to be called, physician-assisted suicide, because the physician only provides the prescription drug. The actual final overt act is taken by the patient. As a matter of terminology, if the physician did take the final overt act, then that would be euthanasia, which is a crime everywhere in the United States. A lot of the patients who get the drugs don't actually ingest them. One-third don't ingest them. So altogether in Oregon, around 1,200 people got the prescription, but only 800 people ever ingested the drugs. Because the idea is just getting the drugs, right? You want to have them there in your on your shelf should your symptoms get bad enough, such that you find your life intolerable. And so it's there as a, you know, like insurance. It's there in case you need it, and sometimes people don't need it, right? It provides some comfort knowing that you have that option available, but it might not be, you might not need to take it. So in 18 years, right, which is, it started in 1997, so you have 18 years of experience of the Oregon law in operation. And the nice thing about the law is, among other things, it has a mandatory reporting requirement, and it captures lots of information, demographic information about how it's been used. And so you can see that the number of prescriptions has been going up, and you see the difference between the blue lines and the green lines, where the blue is the number of prescriptions written, and the green is the number that were actually ingested. And then we know lots more than just the total numbers written and the total numbers ingested. We know things such as almost all these people were white. Almost all of them had health insurance. Almost all of them were enrolled in hospice, and almost all of them had gone to college, right? So this is not being used against the vulnerable poor. If anything, it's quite the opposite. So that was Oregon, right? 1994 ballot, 1997 in operation ever since. In 2008, Washington State had a ballot initiative, just like Oregon had a ballot initiative in 1994, and it passed, which then made Washington the second state to have legalized medical aid in dying in the United States. And now we have, you know, more, and that at the time, right, was based on a 10-year track record in Oregon. Right. And so, again, a very good patient safety track record showing that this law worked. None of the abuses that claimed were risks that might obtain actually obtained. Right. So very, very safe track record. No abuses, no coerced deaths, no bad, terrible deaths. It looked to be working just the way it was intended to work. And so because it was a very positive track record, very robust track record, because of all the data and oversight Washington followed and passed pretty much what Oregon had done. In 2009, what happened, Montana kind of legalized medical aid of dying. Now, this was a court decision, right? So it's not a whole scheme of eligibility criteria and safeguards as in Oregon and Washington. It's just a case in Montana that went to the Supreme Court, and all the Supreme Court did was say it wouldn't be a crime for a physician to do this. Again, sort of distinguishing what we were talking about early on with the terminology, which is this is a conduct that wouldn't fall within the scope of assisted suicide. But there's not a lot of affirmative guidance in Montana, so it's considered to be a state where the practice has been legalized. But it's important to note that it hasn't been legalized in quite the same way as Oregon and Washington. In 2013, Vermont, which enacted legislation, and again, this is legislation, you know, a bill that went through the House signed by the governor, that looks a lot like Oregon and Washington. So now we have, by the end of 2013, four states that in which medical aid in dying is legal. 2014 added a fifth state to that. There was a court decision in New Mexico. So for about 2 years, basically the calendar years of 2014 and 15, generally people would say that 5 U.S. states, medical aid in dying is legal in 5 U.S. states because of this New Mexico court decision. Now, that was just a trial-level decision, and we'll come back to that. Also, in 2014, it's worth noting, just to take a look outside the United States, but right next door, Quebec legalized medical aid in dying. Although it's a very, very different, it looked a lot to Oregon, but it is a very different statute in some material ways from the Oregon model. In 2015, you have the Supreme Court of Canada issue a decision which basically legalized medical aid in dying at the federal level for the entire country of Canada. So again, that's a court decision approach as opposed to the legislative approach that Quebec had taken. Other court decisions in other countries, just to step back for a second around the world, in South Africa, there was an important set of regulations issued in Colombia, and there's a number of other countries where there have been developments. At the end of 2015, just a few months ago, California enacted legislation also modeled on Oregon, Washington, Vermont. This was promoted in a significant part by a California woman who, Brittany Menard, who moved to Oregon because she, at the time California, this was not an option. So she moved to Oregon and utilized the Oregon Death with Dignity Act. Also, factors in California's move were not just the momentum from the story, also the fact that the California Medical Association withdrew its opposition and took a neutral stance, and repeated Gallup polls showing, and Gallup and other polling services showing, that a very large percentage of the public supported this. So this was, again, like Vermont, legislative move, right? So it had to go through the House and the Senate in California and signed by the governor. This happened all at the end of 2018, thereby making California the sixth state, if you want to count New Mexico, the sixth state in which medical aid in dying is legal. Not yet in effect, because the law doesn't take effect until 90 days after the close of the special session, and the special session in which the law was passed hasn't yet ended, so the 90-day clock hasn't even started to run yet. Okay, so that's what's coming up. Well, obviously, California implementation is underway now, and at some point, the actual effective date is coming up. What else is coming up? Well, again, there are bills in many state legislatures. Colorado has a number of bills. Maryland. You look around the country. Many, many states have active bills that actually are being reported out of committees, you know, getting to the floors of the state houses. So too many to summarize here, but it's an active issue in a way more active because of recent developments in California than ever before. And then separate from the legislative approach, so again, you have Washington, Oregon, Vermont, and California all enacted statutes. Montana and New Mexico have court decisions, and there are court cases in other states. So there's a court case in New York. There are still court cases in California, Tennessee, and New Mexico. So this is sort of another way to legalize medical aid in dying. And let me just focus on New Mexico for a second, because it's the most significant, or at least it's the most advanced of all these court cases. So it, as I said, a trial level court said that there was a constitutional right under the New Mexico state constitution to this, and therefore you can't criminalize it. An intermediate appellate court, so there's three levels in New Mexico, an intermediate appellate court said, no, that's not right. This was at the end of 2015, briefed to the Supreme Court of New Mexico, and that court has not yet ruled. So as of right now, the intermediate appellate court ruling said, no, there is no constitutional right, so you might want to take, depending on how you want to count, you might want to take New Mexico off the list, but a lot of people who know or think they can accurately predict court rulings think the New Mexico Supreme Court here will rule as the trial court did and find that there is constitutional right, thus making New Mexico state number 6. I want to mention just one thing maybe about the terminology, a different point about terminology, and that is that many people say, is it legal or illegal? Where is it legal? Where is it illegal? And that might be too simplistic of a way to describe the status of medical aid in dying in various jurisdictions. So, and this is just one continuum, right? But you might say that in some states like New York, put the court, the pending court cases aside, it is illegal in New York, right? This was tested. This was actually, like I said, New York was one of the cases that went to the U.S. Supreme Court. So the practice is illegal in the state of New York. Then there is a state. There's another sort of status, and this might be one example is the British status, which is it's illegal under UK law, just like it's illegal under New York law. But the chief prosecutor has issued a number of guidances over the year, basically saying it is illegal, but we will not prosecute you. We will not prosecute you if it is done in the following way, right? It's not done to get somebody's inheritance, and it's, you know, and the patient is terminally ill. And so it's, I think it's very different, because if you have the relevant, you know, criminal authorities saying, not changing the law to make it officially legal, but they're also saying you're safe legally if you follow the, if you stick to the following, you know, criteria. And so that's a little bit different because you kind of have a little bit of a green light to proceed there. A third status would be what you have in Montana, which you have the state Supreme Court saying it is in fact not illegal, right? So this is even better than the UK, which says it's illegal, but we won't prosecute you. Here they're actually saying it's not even illegal at all. But that's nice, but there's not any guidance. So unlike Oregon, Washington, California, and Vermont, there's no guidance as to who's an eligible patient. Is there a waiting period? How do you do it? Under what conditions? And so you don't have any positive guidance like you do in those other states. And then the final status would be the states like Washington, Oregon, Vermont, and now California, where you do have not just a declaration of legality, but also affirmative clear guidance as to exactly what you're supposed to do. All right. So that's all just a summary of where we are. And that's just because this is all very new. These are all very new developments. It's a very rapidly changing topic, right? Normally we wouldn't summarize state by state what's happening with advanced directive laws or surrogate decision-making laws. But in dying is in flux, and so I think it's worth doing that kind of summary for this issue in a way that it wasn't for some of the other end-of-life law and policy issues. All right, so let's turn to proponent arguments. And the big one here is autonomy, right? Is the same thing we saw in most of the rest of the class is this giant weight that we place on autonomy and self-determination, right? Back to the very beginnings of end-of-life jurisprudence, you know, with the New Jersey Supreme Court in 1976 with Quinlan, with the U.S. Supreme Court in 1991 with Nancy Cruzan, and other cases, through the 70s and 80s, like Dax and Larry McAfee, right? And if we reached a point that we thought, well, look, these people should have, if they find their life intolerable, or if their surrogate determines that they would have found their life intolerable, right? And so the first two, you know, Quinlan and Cruzan, of course, didn't have capacity. Dax and McAfee did. But the point is, we think that either they themselves or their surrogate should be able to make the decision that this is not a condition under which they would want to live. And you can make a decision to hasten your death. That's settled. And so here, too, these patients, Brittany Menard, if you have terminal brain cancer, you're not dependent, you're not on a ventilator like Larry McAfee. You're not on artificial nutrition hydration, right? So you use nothing to turn off. So the prior jurisprudence doesn't literally apply to you, but the underlying principle of having the right to decide when enough is enough does. Okay, so at a more specific level, to use the jurisprudence of the 70s and 80s, early 90s, another argument is just an equal protection argument. And this is a constitutional principle, equal protection, but it's also a principle of, you know, fundamental fairness, which is similarly situated persons should be treated alike. And there, in fact, was a brief that went to the Supreme Court in the 1997 case that basically argued just this, and also, in addition, argued that the people who are dependent upon life-sustaining medical treatment are similarly situated to the people who might want to use medical aid in dying. So it's not fair, right? If they're similarly situated, if you're going to, if a state, like the state of New York, is going to allow those dependent upon dialysis or vents or clinically assisted nutrient hydration to turn that stuff off and hasten their deaths, then it's not fair that they are going to deprive the people who are not dependent upon those things to not hasten their deaths. They're both terminal people. They both want to hasten their deaths. And the fact that the exact clinical mechanism is going to differ is irrelevant. And of course, the Supreme Court in 1997 said they're not similarly situated, and therefore the state can treat them differently. But a lot of smart philosophers with that. All right. Another argument for legalizing medical aid in dying is that it already happens. So there's been a lot of polls, survey evidence, this is just one of them, that a significant number of physicians already do this in all states, right? Physicians in New York, physicians in Texas, right? Where it's definitely illegal. Report, yes, I do it, right? I sometimes help my patient hasten their death by giving them some medications. So so the point is, it's not the case that if we legalize it, then there's going to be all this medical aid in dying. There already is all this medical aid in dying. The only thing that's going to change is that it will be regulated, it will be open, it will be transparent. And so the argument is, make it legal so it can be safer, right? It's not that once you legalize it, there's going to be this practice that is going to come onto the scene that hasn't already been on the scene. It's already on the scene, but it's sort of a back alley, black market. Let's make it safer. So let's turn to the other side and the opponents. Argument is, it's about the integrity of the medical profession, right? Is that doctors are there to heal and to promote, protect life, not to hasten death. So one might analogize this to a whole bunch of major medical associations saying that physicians can't be involved with capital punishment, right? Because again, that's not something we're about as a medical profession. And so, the Board of Anesthesiology will, take away your board certification, the AMA will kick you out, and so forth and so on. So we don't want to be involved with that. And similarly, we don't want to be involved with this either. I think that the capital punishment, we'll put that aside, but this is very, very different. And I think that a very powerful retort to this argument about the mission and integrity of the medical profession has been made by Peter Singer. And Another point is that increasingly, and this is, Medscape is not the only one, although their surveys are pretty big, but now a majority of physicians in the survey and a lot of other surveys now do support it. So this integrity of the medical profession argument, I guess, is weakening because a number of physicians don't agree with that. Another argument against medical aid in dying is that it may not be voluntary. So the safeguards, so the idea that you make sure you have capacity, make the two requests separated by time, the safeguards are all at the time of request. And so some opponents point out that, well, maybe we knew that the patient really, really wanted this. It was a voluntary decision at the time of request, at the time the request for the prescription. But what about when the prescription was consumed, when it was ingested? How do we know that was a voluntary decision? Because there's no safeguards that apply to that conduct. So the patient gets the prescription, picks it up at the Walgreens, takes it home, puts it, right? Who's in the house when the patient consumed it? It's not the physician. It's just the patient and her family. And how do we know what the family's doing? Maybe the family said, "Grandma, you got to take those pills today." That's the argument. Now, there has been zero evidence of this in 18 years from Oregon and 7 years from Washington. So it's a theoretical concern. I guess the risk is there that might happen. But in terms of if you wanted to quantify the risk, got to say it's pretty low since there's no track record on which to base it. And you might note that from earlier in the class that to add in those kinds of safeguards would be anomalous because we don't have anything like those kind of safeguards in the regular life-sustaining treatment context, right? So we barely make sure that the surrogate is even the person who they claim to be before we honor their decisions on behalf of an incapacitated patient. But we don't require all sorts of safeguards that we could require in the withholding and withdrawal context. So you might step back and think, why would we require them in this context? Finally, opponents point to the risk and the danger of a slippery slope. And this is made in lots of different ways. There's conceptual slippery slopes and empirical slippery slopes, lots of different kinds of slippery slopes. Let me just point this out in one way. So I think maybe one way to make the argument here, to make a slippery slope argument, and to make it in a cogent way, is to point to Belgium. And what happened in Belgium? And I guess the argument here is that, look what happened in Belgium. California, Oregon, Washington, and Vermont, tomorrow, or some tomorrow, not literally tomorrow, are going to become like Belgium. What did Belgium do? Well, in Belgium, they basically removed the safeguards. And so the concern is, well, Oregon, Washington, Vermont, and California have these safeguards. There's all these different safeguards in the statute about eligibility and how you get them, how you get the drugs, and so forth. But and maybe they're okay. But there's a risk that those are be deleted later on. And so Belgium may remove the criteria that you be an adult, that you have a terminal illness, and that there be self-ingestion. So these were removed. We sort of expanded the scope of who can get this and made it easier to get. I mean, and there are some cases that might be disturbing, like these brothers who were deaf, but then found out that they were also going blind. I might have got that reversed. Maybe they were blind and going deaf, but decided for that reason, right? So not terminally ill, just disabled in sort of a classic paradigm sense of having a physical disability, but decided that that made their life not worth living. This person had a sex change operation that did not go well and somehow was mutilated in some way and decided that he or she didn't, you know, and wanted to hasten their death. Also, it's worth noting that in 1997, 2% of deaths in the country of Belgium were caused by this drug, by this mechanism. But that went up to 5% in 2013. So it's because of this expanded eligibility criteria, definitely been growing. And it's worth comparing that to Oregon, where it's only 0.2%, right? So it's a 25-time-fold greater usage in Belgium. So again, the argument then would be that maybe we'll, or maybe California will do what Belgium did. So finally, on the slippery slope point, there is one other point to this, which is one of the leading advocates of medical aid in dying in Washington. So she argued one of the Supreme Court cases back in 97, is arguing, very involved in the New York cases now, very involved in a lot of the key developments over the last 20 years. And she had an article at the end of 2015 in the Hastings Center Report, one of our top bioethics journals, basically saying it's time to end the oversight. So all these rules and regulations and criteria and hurdles and procedures in the Death with Dignity Act, it's too much. It's too much. We don't need that oversight. And so she's really defending this idea of legalizing medical aid in dying by court decision, because then you just get a declaration that the patients have a right to it, but you don't have all these little nitty-gritty, fine-grained procedures. So it's interesting that this idea that we'll become Belgium seemed like a theoretical risk, except that you actually literally now have some advocates calling for that. And it's interesting to note, this is that in one of the California cases, this is after the California legislation had been enacted, she continued to litigate that. Effectively, you don't really need the case anymore because California's already legalized medical aid in dying. So why are you litigating a case? Well, because, well, for one, one reason is you might want to get a constitutional right, even though you have a statute, because the statute could always be repealed. It, in fact, has a sunset clause. So there's a reason maybe to get a court declaration that there's a constitutional right to it. But also, she wants a right declared without all of the procedures. And you might expect that there was a response to the Hastings Center report by Steve Latham at Yale saying, man, it's not time for that yet. It's still sort of an experimental sort of thing. And so it's not yet normal enough where we would want to enact it without any of the safeguards. Anyway, this is all just by way of saying that gives some credence to this idea that there's some cause, some cogency to the slippery slope argument.